to introduce Luigi Russi to you all. Luigi being one of our most glorious students in the glorious history of this noble institution. Luigi is graduated last year from the UC, from a two-year program. He is now doing his philosophy doctorate at City University in London. He's recently published this book, Hungry Capital, The Financialization of Food, which, as the title says, explores the global impact of finance, global finance, on food regime in the world. Okay. Well, what else to say? This book will be available in the library as from tomorrow morning for whoever wants to read. I have my personal copy. I am not jealous of my books, so please do ask for this copy. And then I would like to have a second presentation.
I can vote for what Professor Mastruzzo has said because I have known Luigi for the last 3 years and he has been a real support for my academic career throughout my undergraduate degree and later on. And he has been always supporting me, always guiding me, and he was the one who introduced me to IUC and the ideology and how my interests were also, I could develop my interests in a relevant way at this institution. So I think whatever I have achieved till now, a certain part I can really dedicate to Luigi. Thank you.
Well, I have to say that mentoring issue part was very easy because he's a really good student. So I had to have a minimal input and maybe everything else. Let's be fair. So what I'm talking about today is, as I said, is the biggest thing I've done after giving the energy. It's this book called Hungry Capital, the Financialization of Food. And the idea for this book basically came from taking stock of the fact that when we talk about food, it's increasingly less possible to talk about it in a way that is that would be recognizable by somebody that actually grows food at the very bottom. So increasingly, discussion about food and the practice of food production is captured by the calculative practices of finance, I would say. And I thought, you know, this book was both an attempt to try and show how the virtual chemistry happening in some bubble in London goes and affects people growing food, and also an attempt to try and reclaim the possibility to speak about food in ways that that be understandable and be, I would say, familiar to somebody that actually grows food. So, first of all, I have to define my terms. The term financialization is possibly the worst choice of word I could have done because there's so much literature on it and there's so many different meanings that people give to the word financialization that I at least have to shoulder the burden of explaining what I mean by financialization. So you may even see these words. Yes. No. I had memories, but it's a bit rusty. So most of the time, you know, when we talk about financialization, we assume that it has to do with increasing, especially in relation to food. You would say, well, you know, intuitively, financialization of food means that financial markets speculate on food. It is true. It's also only part of the story, I would say, because when I speak of financialization, I mean something both more general and more abstract than just this. Namely, I mean that, you know, there is, you know, the practices of making calculations and plans, and, you know, the discourse that revolves around food, and then the you know, a set of representations that economic representations that hover around food and that then drive what people do with food are dominated by, you could say, financial lingo or financial rationale. So it's more than this. There are other interlocking aspects which I want to illustrate. So one aspect where I believe that the you can still talk about the financialization of food has to do with the way large corporations, large bodies of economic activity bear on the world of food and change the way that food is made. Now I know that here at the AUC you work a lot on the commons, so maybe it might be more intuitive for you to understand, if you think of food as a commons, that the financialization of food can be understood as something that has to do with the depletion of food as a commons. So in particular, if you think of the production of food, it is an organic activity, you could almost say a metabolic activity, whereby we as human beings draw nourishment from the earth. So some people actually speak when we say, you know, when we talk about the production of food, of co-production, because actually if you think about it really hard, you couldn't actually ever make a potato if there wasn't such a thing as a potato in nature. So you never fully make food, but it's a co-production between you and, as the human sort of peasant, and the ecological cycles within nature. And from somebody that is sort of located at ground level, that's what making food is about. It's an organic activity whereby you save the seed from the previous harvest and then you can reuse it the following season, and you try and grow and have a mixed farming with animals, and you can use the manure of the animals to fertilize your field. So it's an interconnected whole, which is very difficult to pry apart. However, when you apply to this particular activity the logic of the logic of having to make a calculation in terms of how much monetary input do I put into something and how much monetary output comes out of something else. So the moment the calculations you make about food are of a financial nature, you find that it's almost impossible to actually stick with this definition of food as a co-production. You have to open it up. So if previously the growing of seed is part of what the peasant always does to save for the next season, you can turn it into a business. So you can have laws like the trade-related aspects of intellectual property in the WTO, whereby you can actually patent seeds. And if you can patent seeds, then you can make a business out of it. And if you can make a business out of it, you can make a calculation in terms of profit in relation to this particular sector, and so on. So I think increasingly there is an attempt to carve business sectors out of food, which reflects then in the composition of what you eat, because increasingly food becomes more and more artificial. Another example that comes, when you take the seeds away from the farmer and the farmer has to pay for the seeds, then of course they have to earn an income in money to pay for those seeds. So they become more dependent on markets, and they have to grow for the markets, and they have to grow for the markets, then they have to increase their production and possibly use fertilizers. So as you can see, it becomes like a treadmill. Once you jump on it, you have to start going faster and faster and faster. And I think this reflects all the way down to what you eat a lot of the time. And today, of course, in this, when discussion about food and the practice of food becomes centered around this imperative, this to reap a financial profit, then the people, well, the actors that are in the best and in the strongest position in along the food chain are supermarkets, because supermarkets have a great advantage over anyone else in the sense that they control access to food on the part of consumers. They have like a certain degree of consumer fidelity. And being able to have that allows you to then dictate the conditions to anyone else that is further down the food chain. So if you can sell food, then you can tell your suppliers how much you want them to sell it to you and how you want it to be done, for example. So you can wield incredible power over everyone else. And then there is another aspect, which is the moment you take food production outside of the sort of practices and discourses and representations that are, I would say, part of an idea of co-production, of food as a commons. The moment you lose that, because you have to carve out business sectors and you have to apply the logic of profit to the making of food, in the end, you can even start debating whether land should be devoted to food production or not. I mean, the very idea, if food is not made to feed people, but to make money, then it's a business just like any other. So you can theoretically imagine, having land compete, alternative uses of land compete with one another. So you can grow food or you can do other stuff with it. You can grow biofuels, you can build, large establishments and so on. So these are broadly some of the topics that I will address. My presentation is divided into roughly three parts. In the first part, I just try to give you a flavor of what I mean by financialization, but really I have to be more precise and I have to explain you a little bit more what I mean by it, because typically the debate around financialization has two main strands of thought. Some people say financialization means that finance is separate from the real economy, so finance and the economy are two separate things. Other people criticize this position and they say, well, actually, finance and the real economy are very close, very much close together, but at the same time, finance has a particular sort of preponderance over other concerns. So I adopt a somewhat intermediate position, which I think students of Teubner will find somewhat more accessible than the average reader. And then I try to contextualize this general discussion about the relationship between food and between finance and the real economy to food. And I will sort of try to go through again some of the topics that I just hinted at briefly here in this introduction. Yes, we can do this. Okay. So for me, financialization has to do with the relationship between two systems. So maybe you've heard, if you just had a class with Teubner, I picked this up with Teubner myself. When you talk about systems, you can of course then talk about food and finance in terms of two separate systems, for example, and that's what I try to do. So let's start very slowly. What is a system? A system is, I would define it as a set of elements that are organized in a particular way. And what is most important to understanding a system is the organizational aspect rather than the single elements. To give you an example, if you have a football team, as long as the rules that connect all the people that are part of the team are the same, as long as they're playing with their feet and they're not doing anything else, then you can still have a football team even if you change the players. So that's why the organizational aspect is more important. Now, what has been done by some sociologists, including Luhmann and Teubner, of course, is to try and apply this sort of idea of a system to social systems. Social systems we talk to you about the legal system and so on. And the way to do that is to imagine that out of the multifarious connections that bind people and various actors in society, that you can isolate those connections that have a particular purpose. So you can imagine, for example, to abstract only those connections that have an economic nature. But I explain further what I mean by that. But if you imagine that you could sort of lift that, you're left with a bubble of specialized communication that revolves around a particular purpose or a particular task. So let me explain, for example, how this happens. In relation to the economy, for example, if you define an economic transaction as something that is characterized by a flow of money, then you can define the economic system as the set of those transactions that happen through money. But there is something more, I think, which is crucial to understand what we talk about when you're talking about the economy, which is the fact that when you are exchanging money in an economic transaction, the exchange of money is a proxy for the transfer of ownership of goods and services. So that's a crucial. So money is a proxy for an exchange of actual things. And some scholars then have said, but this does not actually include all possible flows of money that you can have in the modern world, because you have flows of money that occur without any regard for the transfer of the property of something, but you throw the money that happened with a view to get more money out of them. So it's a purely self-referential flow of transferring money to get more money. And these particular flows are actualized by, are made possible by something which lawyers are very familiar with, and that's contracts, and a particular subset of contracts, which are derivative contracts. Now, a derivative contract is a financial instrument, as you probably know that, whereby the value of which depends on the value of an underlying asset. So I show you several ones later on, but so let's just think about derivatives a little bit more, because when, if the value, so in a derivative contract, as I said, the value does not really, what you're interested in is just the variations in the value of the underlying asset. It doesn't really matter what the underlying asset is. So, you know, as some scholars have said, for example, that derivatives allow you to appropriate, to actually, what you own when you own a derivative is not the good, but is the fluctuations in value of the good. So you own, ownership in this case is almost, becomes so empty as to almost mean nothing really. You're not really owning anything. And they have, so this, on the one hand, they're abstract from transactions that involve the exchange of goods and the transfer of ownership. And on the other hand, they have this crazy nature that basically they allow you to compare different assets. Let me give you an example of that so that we sort of know what we're talking about. In food, you know, we come across, there are some derivatives which are called commodity index swaps that they're basically, I'll explain them further later on, but they're basically, they're based on a mathematical formula, the value of which is the weighted average of the prices of a number of different commodities. So it's an index, it's a formula. The final value of which depends for, you know, say 30% on the value of oil and gas, 60% on the value of grain and so on. So what this does, this formula, is that once grain and gas are included in a derivative instrument, it becomes relevant if you want to decide whether to buy that derivative or not, to see how their prices compare to one another and how they change in relation to one another. So why normally gas and food would be completely separate types of assets? And, you know, what happens to the price of grain shouldn't necessarily affect what happens to the price of oil, at least not directly. Once they're in a derivative, it becomes relevant to compare them. And so you can imagine that, you know, so this is what I mean by the fact that you can blend assets. Another example is a convertible bond. No? A convertible bond is a bond, so it's a debt that you can convert into equity. So in accounting theory, debt and equity are two separate things, are two different types of assets. But once they're in a bond, it becomes relevant to the owner of the derivative to know how their prices vary relative to one another. So you enable the commensuration of stuff, which is not necessarily related in the real economy. And so if you imagine that your derivatives open the possibility of making anything comparable to anything else, which is why I chose this picture. This is a panopticon. It was an ideal prison where everyone can see everyone else. So while you're in the prison, knowing that someone else may be observing you, you are drawn to comply with the rules of the prison. And I think the same happens to some extent. The same sort of structure is created by derivatives. If you imagine derivatives as a system of things, of contracts that allow you to compare and that make it relevant to compare everything to everything else, then you end up with a system where the profitability of certain assets like food has to try and match as much as it can the profitability of other assets like insurance claims or, you know, the price of gas and so on. So it creates this profoundly unnatural relation. And so this is quite, I hope that I haven't lost too many people here. But I'll illustrate this further in really specific in relation to food. So what you're left with is a situation whereby in an economy, in a financial system which is held up by derivatives and where the profitability of everything can be compared to anything else, then of course it becomes relevant to try and make any asset as performing as possible in terms of profits. And so it becomes relevant, if you actually own the asset, to restructure it in such a way as to make it more profitable according to a certain financial metric. So basically the financial system, I would say, increases the pressure on anything, on any economic activity, to deliver higher profits and to squeeze that activity. And we see how badly this squeezing goes when it comes to food, in order to make whatever activity you have streamlined for the production of profit. And this, of course, leads you to very difficult trade-offs, because when it comes to food, you cannot. You're walking a very rickety bridge if you think that you can restructure the production of food, which is something basic to our very existence on Earth, to make it into something that can deliver a profit. And so I would say that, you know, but because both the financial system and the economic system run on money, so it's money transactions allow the communication between the two, I would say. So this is my
libertarian reference, I would say. Now, of course, this is my bigger doctrinaire reference, because this is basically what I just tried to say, that when you have a system, of course, any system thrives on an environment of relationships that are different. No? When I try to define how you define a system, no? I said, think all the relationships you have, or, you know, that exist in society, and try to abstract only those with a certain content. If you draw a system like that, this does not eliminate all the other relationships that you've left out. So, and all those other relationships that you leave out are actually fundamental to the very existence of, say, an economic system. So, the problem that you have then is when the economy, for example, has to streamline everything in order to basically transform as many other relationships as possible into economic relationships, then you end up with a situation where it might be even difficult for the system to survive. And this is particularly evident with food. Because, of course, you know, if you basically, you know, when you're a system, or think of the economic system, or any system, we are also biological systems, so maybe that's an easier thing to do. But if you think about it, you need to get something from the environment to reproduce yourself, your cells and everything, and you let out some waste in the environment. And of course, this can only go on insofar as you don't take too much from the environment, so that the environment can regenerate that which you need to reproduce yourself. And so long as you don't let out such an amount of waste that the environment cannot recycle it. So as long as these two conditions hold, then you can have a symbiotic relationships between a system and its environment. When this breaks down, you know, so when the system essentially tries to expand and leave, you know, less and less free space out of it, in the end there's no more environment from the system to draw from. So this is a bit theoretical. I try to illustrate that this relates to food more specifically. What I wanted to show so far was simply that when we are discussing the topic of financialization, we are basically confronted with a problem related to the relationship between the financial system and the economic system. The financial system has this particular characteristic that it is centered around flows of money, the only purpose of which is to produce more money, rather than transfer goods and services and make stuff. And so while on the one hand I've said that you could think, you know, that finance and the economy are separate, I would say they are to some extent, but to another extent, the financial system affects the economy very much. So they're also, at another level, they're connected, which I think is what generates a lot of controversy in the debate on financialization, because it doesn't really matter so much whether they're separate or they affect one another, as long as you can make some inroad into understanding how they relate to one another. And as the financial system is so centered on the production of money and the enhancement of profit, and most importantly, as it establishes relationships of comparability between different classes of assets, so like food and oil, for example, the more it creates a pressure to try and make food perform as much as oil. So if you're a food company, you have to try and
and offer profit levels which are comparable to those which an investor would get by investing in oil. And of course, the way you achieve that is by acting on the food chain in ways that that can end up ousting some of those non-economic relationships that are essential to the production of food. So let's get into the food bit. This was most theoretically. So let's start from the from the more intuitive way of thinking about financialization of food, which is the direct financial speculation. In 2007-2008, there was a crisis in the prices of foodstuffs. Basically, the price of food went up by a lot. And a lot of people in various countries found themselves excluded by the possibility of buying even that food. This created a number of riots. And a number of economists they rushed in to try and explain this crisis in terms of market factors, in terms of supply or demand. Some people have said, for example, that there had been bad harvests, so that the supply of food had decreased. Others said, actually, people worldwide, because of the rise of the middle classes, are eating much more meat. And when you eat much more meat, that means that you have to produce grain not just to feed people, but also to feed the animals, which are then fed to people. So animals compete with humans in this respect for grains, and so this increases the demand on the production of food. Others have said biofuel, which is fewer crops that are grown to make fuel rather than food, are competing. So these are, to some extent, they all have a grain of truth, but I think they miss something quite important, which I think instead allows you to understand exactly how deep the influence that the financial system can have, the financial system has on the production of food. In fact, what is interesting is that all of these crises started happening right after the year 2000. And what happened in 2000 was that the market for commodity derivatives was liberalized in the US, which is the biggest commodity market in the world. And basically, this meant that you could actually draw up derivative contracts pertaining to commodities. There was no limits to how many you could draw these contracts, and to who the parties should be. So normally a derivative contract in food would be something that you might want to do, say, if you're, to oversimplify, if you're a baker and you need grain, and you know that you're going to need grain in 1 month to make bread, it might make sense for you to enter into a contract for future delivery of grain. So you pay for it today, but you know that you're going to have the grain in 1 month. So it makes sense to use some derivative contracts if you are an operator of food. If you're Goldman Sachs, it's harder to find a rationale why you should be buying and selling derivatives on food. And so let's get back to, after 2000, there was this boom in derivatives trade and commodities, and one particular type of derivatives became particularly fashionable, and that's called the commodity index swap. A commodity index, as I mentioned earlier, it's a mathematical formula which is the weighted average of the prices of a number of different things. So the value, this is the UBS commodity index, for example. So it's an index drawn up by an investment bank, which has the price of which depends on the prices of a number of different other commodities. So this is also what I meant earlier about the blending function of derivatives, because once agricultural product. Once agricultural products are included inside, can be included inside the derivative values, in order to decide these percentages, it makes sense to know how the price of agriculture varies relative to precious metals, for example. So you are actually including the prices of food in something like this. You are allowing the comparability of food and of the profitability of how profitable it is to make food with other stuff. And that's what is peculiar about derivatives, which you don't normally have. Because normally you would have somebody making bread competing with someone else that makes bread. But when somebody that makes bread is competing with somebody that makes precious metals, that's a totally different game. And so, this would be a commodity index swap. would be a contract whereby you would have some financial player with a lot of money to park. Think of a pension fund where all the pension money goes, and they have loads of money to park. And they would go to work. Actually, they would be offered by Goldman Sachs or UBS something like this. UBS would say, look, we enter into a swap. A swap is a contract where you exchange cash flows. So basically, UBS would tell the pension fund, you give me the cash flow on a treasury bond, or the interest that you would get from a treasury bond, and as in return, I will give you the cash flow arising from the variation in the value of the index. So far, there is no food that has been bought and sold. It's just a contract. So somebody's saying, I deliver you the returns of treasury bonds in exchange for the returns on the commodity index. The purpose of something like this would be that the pension fund is exposed to the commodity market without actually having to own any of this food. So it's a synthetic ownership of food. You're owning food without owning any food. And that's the theory that makes people do these sort of contracts. But as I will try to show you, this pyramid eventually ricocheted down and actually affected the very supply of food. Because basically, in this particular, so then one other thing, imagine then that you're Goldman Sachs and you've just signed a contract like this. So you have to give someone else a cash flow that matches the variations in the value of this index. So what you would do then as a financial operator is something called hedging. You would try to get yourself, you would try to invest in such a way as to generate a flow of cash such that you will be in a position to give this cash flow to the pension fund. Yes? So the way to do that, if you are Goldman Sachs, is to go and buy futures. So futures basically you buy and sell commodities for future delivery. So you would buy grain for delivery within 30 days, so that by closing those future positions, you could have a cash flow that somehow tracked the value of the index. So UBS in this case, in order after entering into an index swap, they would go and buy 27% of agricultural futures, 34% of energy futures, and so on. Which leaves you with the problem that this contract, the contract between UBS and the pension fund, has no end to it. There's no set date in this contract. It's an ongoing relationship. What UBS does in order to generate this cash flow is it buys futures. And a future is a contract that has a limited duration because it's future delivery. So when the delivery date comes to you, either you take delivery of the grain or you roll over this position into a new future. You close that and you go into the future. So you have a mismatch between the duration of the commitment and the behavior that this financial operators would undertake in order to hedge this commodity. They would enter into repeated contracts. They would buy futures repeatedly and repeatedly. This type of behavior, that you secretly buy stuff just because you have to comply with the contract without actually looking at what's going on in the futures market, creates movements in the market for futures that are not related to anything that's actually any real market factors related to supply and demand. So this gave rise to a particular situation whereby, normally when you buy grain for future delivery, you are effectively taking out an insurance. So if you are a baker, you want to know today how much you pay. So you enter into a futures contract and so you're kind of taking out insurance against the fluctuations in price. So typically, the curve of the price in the future would be something like this. Because if you want to sell grain today, then you have a certain price. If you want to sell grain for delivery within 1 month at a set price, you have to also pay an insurance premium, which is reflected in a lower price. So typically, the prices of futures would be something like this. What happened because of the commodity index trade instead was that the sort of predictability that was built into the market by the systematic buying and selling, which was done by financial operators like UBS, purely to hedge a commitment with a pension fund, created a certain predictability. I don't actually have the time to go into the full details of that, but I went on questions of that, but I'm very curious later. And eventually, sort of the price curve for futures became something like this. When it becomes something like this, if you place yourself here, saying you're actually somebody that actually makes grain and has access to storage facilities, it is now more profitable for you to actually store this grain and try to sell it at 8 months rather than sell it today. So what we are facing here is a situation whereby the price signals which were created in the financial markets by trades that had nothing to do with the production and consumption of food sort of traveled down the chain until people who actually were buying and selling grain, looking at this price curve, decided, well, why should I sell the grain today? I'll keep it. And so they actually withdrew supply from the market, which led to an increase in the prices of food and the price crisis. So this is one, you don't have to follow all the sort of technicalities of my reasoning. What I wanted to show, though, is that what we are facing here is something that is not captured by any of the market explanations that I mentioned earlier, or that people are eating too much meat, because it actually had nothing to do with how much food was made and how much food was needed. But it actually simply had to do with the fact that UBS had to, or Goldman Sachs, or another investment bank, had to hedge a contractual commitment with a pension fund. And to do that, it had to act on financial markets in such a way as to then sort of alter the normal price structure, which was then interpreted by people who were actually buying and selling grain with the idea that they should actually hoard it. And that hoarding gave rise to a lack of supply and increase in price. So this is one aspect. So let's move on and think about other things. Because as I said, financialization is not just about using food becoming only a financial asset, but food is also looked upon as an asset that can be acted upon by a company, for example, and streamlined in order for that company to make a higher profit from that business sector. No? So you can think, for example, of I mentioned earlier that food is the production of food. Sorry. The production of food should really be thought of, if you apply the logic of the commons to it, as an activity of co-production, where it's not just you and the field, it's you and the field and the relationship that the nematodes inside the field have with the earth, and they fertilize the earth. So it's a set of very intricate, it's an ecosystem, basically. And you are, of course, it's an ecosystem in which there is a certain element of human design. But that human design could never work without the underlying ecological relations. No, as I said earlier, if there were no potatoes, you couldn't actually make a potato. You can grow potatoes because they're there, because there are certain ecological relationships that are such that you can have a potato, but you can't actually engineer one. And so, what happens though is when you stop looking at food as a set of relationships of co-production, but you try and carve business centers out of it, then what you have to try and do is you have to come in with a machete and try to cut, to demarcate areas which are not really there. You try to make markets. So for example, one case of course is the market for seeds. The moment you introduce ownership of seeds, then of course, that then becomes a business sector, because you can have a company which does genetic research, which thinks about how to make seeds and then sells those seeds. So that company, once the production of seeds becomes fenced and becomes a business sector, then you can look at it as something over which it is plausible to apply the financial logic of how much monetary input comes in, how much monetary output I get, and how much profit I've made in between. Although it's not there originally, it's not there in the structure of the seeds. In fact, in traditional farming, as a farmer, you would try to make your own seeds so that you could exchange them with other farmers, so you would have a set of non-monetary relationships. So the whole But when a company has to compete on, let's say, on financial markets for equity or for financing, then it has to show that it is able to reap a certain profit from something. And in order to do so, it has to introduce barriers. So, and of course, you know, you can't really, once you start, it's very difficult to see where you end up, because, you know, then once you start fencing the seeds, then you know, as a farmer, you need to pay for the seeds. If you need to pay for the seeds, you need to earn an income in money. So it doesn't matter what you grow, it only matters what you can sell or what you grow. So you have to start growing stuff in such quantities, and also the type of stuff that will sell. But at the same time, if you have to start growing more stuff, you are going to probably end up with a monoculture, you know, with a field of just one crop, which doesn't actually exist in nature. If you walked in the wood, you've never come across something that looks all the same. And the reason it's not all the same is that if it was, and there was an insect that particularly liked that particular plant, it would be wiped out in a day. But if you have only that, you know, that particular plant, and you're a farmer, then you need to use something extra. You need to use a fertilizer or a pesticide. And so then you can have another market here, which is the market for biochemicals. And then you end up in a sort of treadmill, because then the more chemicals you need, the more money you need to pay for those chemicals, and the more you need to try and industrialize your production of food. So what you enact is a slow motion between a sort of traditional subsistence, possibly organic agriculture, to something that becomes increasingly dependent on technological inputs. Of course, this second theme which you get at, and which is very common today, is very good for business. You know, you can understand it very well in terms of, if you apply to it, a financial logic of reaping a profit out of it, whereas what you had at the beginning didn't make any sense financially, but it actually made a lot of sense from another perspective. And if this can go, there's no real limit to this particular process. And I want to show this, I think there's an ad after this. Yes, let's have a look at this ad. Ah, this is more, oh, this is the subtitles. This was aired on Italian TV. Right, so this is milk, or is it milk? That's the question. This is something which was, maybe you've heard of Arma. Arma is an Italian company that went bust in 2003. And right around that time, Parmalat had a lot of debt which it needed to refinance, because it didn't have enough money to pay for its existing debt. So it had to renegotiate and say, well, will you give me an extension to the banks and something? So when you do that, in order for the renegotiation, for the refinancing to be successful, you have to show that you have enough sources of projected income that you can rely on. You can say, look, I have a new source of profits against which, from which I'll be able to draw the money with which I'll be able to pay this debt. So you have to open up new business sectors. And of course, Parmalat was working in milk, and he thought, well, why don't we, in dairy mostly, so why don't we open a new business sector? Now, if you ever bought Parmalat milk, it's traditionally Parmalat milk used to be only the packed one, the one that you can sort of, that you can keep on the shelves at home for, you know, however long you want. They thought, well, why don't we expand on fresh milk? The thing with fresh meat is that there are a set of rules around what counts as fresh meat, because, you know, fresh meat goes bad very quickly because it's got a number of things inside, or because it's alive, in fact. And this makes it, of course, very nutritious, but it makes it problematic if you're a multinational to try and buy it from farm and sell it, you know, for cheap and selling it in another market. So Parmalat's idea was, first they lobbied the regulator in order to make sure that you could sell as fresh milk something which had undergone a process called microfiltration. Microfiltration allows you to take all the stuff that's alive in milk out, take the milk somewhere else, and then sort of put it in later. So what you get at the end is a fresh blue milk, as they market it. And of course, it's it's probably crap compared to fresh meat. But at the same time, it opens a new business sector. You know, Parmalat can then use the evidence of this particular operation to get their debt refinanced. And in the way, so they basically try to apply this global sourcing strategies. So they would buy meat in Poland, and then they would try to import it in Italy, something which takes about 2 weeks to go. So if you actually eat the fresh meat like that, you're gonna, by the time it gets to where you need it, it's gonna be battered. But if you can microfiltrate it, you can still sell it as meat. You know, and you can still sell it as fresh meat, and you can compete with fresh meat producers who probably face much higher costs. So you're basically offering, from a financial perspective, it's a great idea. But of course, this gives you an idea just of the extent to which the financial pressure to streamline food into something that can be understood in terms of profits, it can go as far as changing what you understand as fresh meat, and you can fill you with things, you know, quite deeply. And then I mentioned supermarkets earlier. Supermarkets, of course, have a great, they are ideally positioned. You know, when all that matters about food is profits, if you're actually able to control the access that consumers have to food, you have a guaranteed source of income from those consumers. So that puts you in the position to exert an insane amount of power on everyone else. And here, actually, I want to give you an example which was quite recent to England, and I posted something on the Common Sense blog, something that is part of the IUC, which not many people read, but I write to it. So basically, what happened in England recently was there was a scandal because some very large supermarkets started expanding from just stocking other companies' products into making their own brand. So you can buy, not just that you can buy Nestle coffee, you can buy Tesco coffee. And the same thing, in England, in this case, there was a case with burgers. Maybe you've heard about it, you know that you have. Yes, they were selling beef burgers. And then it turned out that they made checks, and these burgers actually contained a certain amount of horse meat. Horse meat is actually very, very tasty, very good. The problem was that you don't know that meat was there. You don't know which horses it came from. You don't know what antibiotics those horses were treated with. And so it was very unsettling. How did this happen, people, you know, all over the newspapers? Actually, my question would be, why does it not happen more often? Because in fact, if you... when you're a Tesco or you're another big retailer and you have access to consumers, you can go to, and then you decide to make your own burgers. So you go to somebody and say, look, I'm going to outsource you my production of burgers. So we enter into a contract, you give me burgers. And I set the conditions at which you give me those burgers. So those burgers, you have to sell them to me at 50p each, because otherwise I'm not going to take them. And if I say I'm not going to take them, you are out of business. So you want to make sure that you make burgers which you can sell at Tesco for 50p, so that Tesco can make a profit. And also the great advantage is that in this situation, all the engineering with food that might involve a health hazard, like in this case, is externalized. You know, it's not me, the supermarket, that actually takes the blame for it. You know, it's the bad provider of meat in this case. So you you have this incredible power which you can wield. Which, you know, in one sense, it was always supermarkets were built around controlling the consumer experience. You know, the very first supermarket was actually quite an innovation, because originally you would go to a market and have a clerk fetch the stuff for you. So the idea of having consumers go shop around the lanes and actually, you know, allowed you to fire clerks and have consumers do that sort of work. And you could then, you know, manage, even today, you know, there are even chips inside the carts, and you could sort of, you know, they know how to put the stuff inside the aisles, and there are differential levels of pricing for where the food is. So there, you know, there's a whole economy that's based around the fact that there are some players which actually control the access to consumers. And then, you know, of course, when you know, you lose track of the fact that food is also is about co-production. It's about trying to also maintain certain ecological relationships. when you lose track of that and of the fact that you know the production of food is there because people need food, and you're trying to open a number of business sectors which are all based roughly around the production of food, then you can even start thinking about then what are the best uses of land from a financial perspective? You know, after all, maybe food is not as competitive as oil, for example. You know? So maybe I can try and use that land to make oil or to make something like fuel or biofuel. So this is, I think, is the ultimate level to which the financialization of food, or how you see speak, the disruption of food as a commons can go, to the point that the very production of food becomes disposable. And of course, this is very interesting to lawyers as well. Well, this is one example. You know, in India, there was a case where there was an expropriation of peasant land to build, you know, an IT city. Another example could be, you know, the growing of biofuel. Now, this is where it's jatropha, it's something from the seeds of which you can squeeze it and make fuel. It's quite interesting what I was saying to lawyers, because of course there is a whole development institutions, especially the World Bank, have given, you know, a sort of qualified approval to something like that, to land grabbing. Which is, you know, the large-scale acquisition of farmland to make various things around the world, because according to their development perspective, it's actually a great occasion of foreign direct investment. You know, the theory behind it is that developing countries don't have enough savings of their own with which they can finance their own industrialization. So if you have people coming in and investing, then the idea is that they're going to make up for the shortfall in savings that the developing country has. So there is the World Bank, for example, issued these principles for responsible agricultural investment, which have been criticized by the UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Food, which tends to be the more sort of critical voice in these matters, as basically being just a set of checklist that you like corporate social responsibility, or tick, I got consent, tick, 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 okay, you take your life. It is very controversial. And then now I come to sort of the last thing actually of my talk, because I don't like gloomy endings. So I wanted to show you some of the stuff that people are doing in order to counter the fact that relationships centered around the production of food are being increasingly rewired according to a logic that is not that of co-production. It's not that of creating a resilient productive base or promoting rural communities or of creating viable environments. But there are sort of reactions happening which are quite intriguing. So one actually is from Italy, and I actually came across this when I was a student at the AUC. And I was meeting peasants around where I come from in Cuneo. And there was this peasant who introduced me to this particular network of markets, and it's very interesting. It's called the genuino clandestino, which means genuine clandestine, because it hinges on a problem which is quite, it hinges on a problem that's quite unsettling, because it shows you how state regulatory apparatuses sometimes have a play a part bad evolution that the world of food is taking. Because when you make health and safety regulations today in a mostly industrialized economy, they are even industrialized food economy, you make them with having in mind a huge producer, like a factory. You know, if a bacteria goes into a factory, it's probably, you know, the risk of poisoning, you know, thousands of people is immense. So you want to make sure that you regulate very tightly. Now, if you apply those same rules to a peasant who makes, you know, grows some food for himself, maybe makes some jam with, you know, maybe makes, you know, 100, you know, things of jam, that's hardly the same, you know, throughput of, the same output of jam. But, you know, if you start asking the peasant, you should plaster the walls of your kitchen, you can't make the jam in your kitchen, for example, because jam is for you, then, and if you do that, you won't be able to sell your stuff in a supermarket. So you're actually denying the peasant, you know, the access to some moderate source of income to differentiate their activity. So these markets have the idea of creating sort of new connections and bypassing sort of supermarkets as to enable a new form of connectivity that may help sort of bolster the resistance of the peasantry, not make the peasantry fully disappear. Then there's another one which I've come across from England, which I've come across, and these are our own pictures, by the way. So this is actually it's a thing which I've seen in a place called Totnes, and it's an experiment called community supported agriculture, where the idea is that the community sort of takes charge of the farmer, of the local sort of peasant community, and they enter into an agreement with the farmer, and they say we buy a stake in your little field. But in exchange for this money, you're not going to give us more money like a dividend, you're going to give us like food, you know? So they get sort of a weekly delivery of something. So this way, you are giving a guaranteed market to the farmer, because you are sort of paying in advance and then getting the food later. So the farmer knows that he has a guaranteed market. And when he does know that he has a guaranteed market, then he doesn't necessarily have to get on that treadmill where he needs to use fertilizers and, you know, in order to make a certain output to sell on the market. So you are also encouraging farmers to experiment maybe with organic agriculture, which requires a bit of tender loving care and patience, especially at the beginning, because when you transition from fertilizer-based agriculture to organic agriculture, in the long run, it's just as productive, but you have a sort of slouch, just as if you're like somebody on drugs, you're very efficiently on drugs, and then if you withdraw, you have a bit of a slump before you become normal again. So it's a similar reason. So yes, this is a. Yeah. I like the picture, but this is something that this. So this, we get to the end of this. I tried to pack almost everything I said in the book in about an hour. I think I failed miserably. So, ultimately, I try to recapitulate. I try to, maybe you can now draw the connections between what I say in the first part, which is a bit heavily theoretical, but try to show you how this progressive autonomization of finance, of financial flows with respect to economic flows, creates a pressure to restructure. Maybe you hear this term very often, we need to restructure this industry. You can restructure agriculture as well. And this pressure to restructure agriculture can go to great lengths, so such that food doesn't just become a financial asset, but it also the very idea of what is food becomes changed by the financial pressures, like in the fresh meat that I showed you earlier, that the definition was changing. And then of course the violence of this process at the same time ignites some counter work, as I mentioned earlier, that you have small issues which are quite very, very small scale, but at the same time they allow me to end the presentation of the meeting. Yes, thank you.